Hey guys, in this week's video, we're going to learn how to spot the signs and symptoms of a heart attack. We're going to learn what to do during that situation. We're going to learn what to do if it turns into a cardiac arrest. And also, we're going to discuss preventative tips and loads more. I really hope you find this information helpful, as it could mean that you could save someone's life if it's needed. Now, before we begin, please remember, if you think you or someone else is having a heart attack right now, please do not delay and ring 999 immediately. Ring your emergency services immediately, as any delay can make things worse. Please do not delay things. If you think someone's having a heart attack right now, call 999. This video is just for educational purposes. It's not meant to replace them at all. Now, with that important message over and done, hopefully you're watching this video just to learn what to do in case someone has a heart attack and to spot those signs and symptoms. This is going to be quite a long video. We're going to be going through it all in quite a lot of detail. So if at any point you want to find any specific information, please do feel free to click on that description below and click on any chapter that is relevant to you. However, I would highly, highly recommend that you watch the entire video. So to begin with, what are the main symptoms of a heart attack? One of the main symptoms that many patients discuss is a crushing pain in the chest area, okay? And this can last for several minutes, or it can start and stop in bouts. Now, this crushing pain can come on suddenly for some people and feel very intense. And in others, it may be a gradual building discomfort. Some people describe it as a feeling of pressure on the chest, almost like you have an elephant sitting on your chest or a very heavy object squeezing it or making it feel tight. The pain often first starts in the chest, but for some people, it may also radiate outwards to include the arms, neck, jaw, and back. Now, it's important to remember, although chest pain is the most common symptom, some men and women may not experience it at all during a heart attack. So this is quite important for you to remember. Chest pain is important, but some people just don't experience it. Now, with the elderly, women, and diabetics, sometimes the chest pain can be mild, so it's also important to be aware of the other symptoms to look out for as well. Now, with regards to the other symptoms, there's quite a few to be aware of, so I'm gonna have a little box appear here with all of the symptoms for you to be aware of. Give it a read. Some things include like nausea, vomiting, difficulty breathing, being pale, sweating profusely. There's loads and loads of symptoms, so feel free to pause the video, give it a read. But the most important thing is, if you suspect anyone is having a heart attack, if anyone's having these sort of symptoms and you're suspecting they might have a heart attack, don't leave it to chance. Just call 999 immediately. So if you have any of these sort of symptoms and you're worried about them, call 999 immediately and get urgent medical advice. That is the most important thing for you to be aware of. And please remember this, that it's much better to receive medical advice and medical treatment earlier rather than later. So even if it's not a heart attack, don't be concerned about getting some help, okay? Don't wait for things to get worse, and time is precious, okay? Because if it is a heart attack, the longer you leave it, that means that you're gonna have much lower chances of survival and recovery. The sooner you get medical treatment and medical advice, the recovery rates increase massively. Now let's move on to the next point. So you've rang the ambulance, you think someone's having a heart attack. The next thing that you really should do is get them to sit down, to rest, and also, if you have aspirin available, give the aspirin to the patient to take, to the person to take, but make sure they have no allergies to aspirin, and you need to give them a 300 milligram tablet of aspirin, ideally, and get them to chew it and then swallow it. This is gonna help thin the blood, and if there is any clot, it's gonna help the clot not get any bigger. But please remember this, that if you don't have any aspirin at home, please don't worry. Instead, stay with the person that you think is having a heart attack. That is the most important thing. So please don't go out to quickly go and get some aspirin. Stay with that person. And the reason that I'm saying you need to stay with that person is that your responsibility now is to look after that person and keep them calm. Because as you can imagine, they're probably super worried, as you are as well. So you need to keep them calm, remain calm, because otherwise the heart's gonna be pumping faster and things could get worse. Also remember, another reason why you have to be there is because you're gonna be monitoring them. And if you feel like they're getting worse, you need to call 999 again and get more advice from them. That's also an important factor that you need to bear in mind. Now, the next thing that you need to do whilst you're waiting for the paramedics to arrive is you need to start writing down some information for them to make their life easier so they can process things quicker. So for example, you need to write down the patient's name, their date of birth, their GP address, so which GP practice they register at. If they're on any medicines, get them out and keep them there with them so that they can have a look at them and make a note of them. Also, let them know if you've given them an aspirin. This is really important. So when they come in, you can check in with the paramedic, let them know that this is XYZ patient, they're on these medicines, they've got no allergies, and I've given them an aspirin 300 milligram, which they've chewed and swallowed. All this information is gonna be vital for them, and don't forget, if they know of any allergies as well that the patient might have, let them know about that as well. Now, another important factor to consider is if you live in an apartment or a flat anywhere like that, it's a bit difficult to find, or if you live in a house, which is really difficult to find, if there's anyone else with you, you might want to get them involved as well to help the paramedics find you. So if you might need to unlock some doors, or if you might need to send them down so they can guide the paramedics where to go. The reason we're doing all this is just to speed up the time that you receive medical attention or the patient receives medical attention. These are all super important factors that no one really thinks about, so it's important to discuss them as well. Now, whilst you're waiting for the ambulance to arrive, it's important that you're constantly monitoring the person that you're with, because you need to check if their symptoms or their condition is getting worse. So if the person that you're with stops breathing, or they stop moving, or they're no longer responsive to touch or speech, so when you're talking to them, they're no longer responsive to it, this could be a sign that they've lost consciousness and could potentially be a cardiac arrest. Now, in this situation, it's vital that you start CPR immediately and that you ring 999 immediately, or your emergency line, whatever the number is, 911, 999, and get advice. You need to let them know straight away that the patient has now lost consciousness, and they will be able to guide you in what you need to check for and what you need to do. CPR stands for cardiopulmonary resuscitation and usually involves pressing on the person's breastbone to try and restart their heart. In adults, we do this with 30 compressions alternated with 2 rescue breaths. However, due to coronavirus, the most recent Resuscitation Council guidance advises instead of a hands-only CPR without the breaths. Continuous chest compressions can still save a life. Now, when it comes to doing CPR, there's some really good videos on YouTube showing you exactly how to do it, and I would highly recommend that you watch those videos. I will leave links to them in the description below. If you don't know how to do it, please do watch them. Whilst we're on the topic, I'll go through it very basically now as well, but I feel like them videos will do a better job because they're really demonstrating it on a patient or a mannequin, so you can see how it's done. So to begin with, you're gonna put the heel of your hand, so here, onto the chest like so, and you're gonna interlock your other hand into it like so, so that the heel is also on the top, so you're pressing together, if that makes sense. So now that we know what we're doing with the hands and how we're interlocking it and using the heel to push down on the chest, the next thing you need to know is that you're gonna use your body weight to push down. So I can't really show you very well here, but you're gonna use your whole body weight instead of just pushing with your arms like so. By using your body weight, it's gonna be much easier to do so. And also, you need to remember, you're gonna aim for about 100 to 120 chest compressions per minute. When you're pushing down, each compression needs to be about 5 to 6 centimeters that you're pushing down. That's about 2 inches. So when we say 100 to 120 chest compressions per minute, that's about 2 chest compressions per second. So it's quite intense, and you need to continue this until the ambulance comes. But remember, when you ring 999 or the emergency services, they will run through this with you. They sometimes put a beat in the background that you can continue with. But please do remember, watch those videos on chest compressions and how CPR is done properly. Again, I'm gonna leave links to them in the description below, and I'd highly recommend you watch them just to refresh your knowledge. Even if you think you know what you're doing, just watch it again every now and then just to refresh your knowledge. This could be what saves someone's life. Now, CPR is super vital, but remember, if you have access to something called an automated external defibrillator, AED, which we call it for short, this could potentially save someone's life even more, in fact, by up to 5 times. Now, these AEDs usually come as a pack. They've got all the instructions inside that you'll follow. You'll stick these sticky pads on the patient, and then they're gonna transmit a small electric shock, which is aiming to restart the heart back to its normal natural rhythm. Now, it does sound a bit complicated, but they're very simple to use. You don't have to be medically trained to use it. They come full of instructions for you to follow. Now, these AEDs can be found in loads of different locations. I'm sure if you're here in the UK, you've probably seen them. They're sometimes on phone boxes, they're sometimes in shopping malls, they're sometimes just randomly when you're walking, you'll see them stuck on a wall. They're usually nice and bright, but they've usually got a little pin code that you have to put in to open it. Now, if you know that one is close by, where you are with the patient, and if you rang 999, they will give you the pin code to get it, to access it. Also, a lot of shops have them nowadays, so if it's happened in a shop or anywhere public, a lot of people do have access to them that can bring them and help you. Now, a recent survey done showed that 3/4 of people don't feel very comfortable using an AED. So if you're one of them, please do find out more information about it. There is a really useful video on how to use them as well, which I will leave a link to in the description below. It's always good to have a bit of knowledge about how to use these things as well. I always find it very helpful to watch something beforehand, and then I know when I've got it, then it's not going to be completely new to me. I've got some understanding of how to use it, and I really hope this video helps with that as well. Now let's move on to angina or a heart attack. If you're someone that suffers from angina, it can sometimes be a little difficult to know whether you're having an angina attack or a heart attack. Now, angina is the chest pain that occurs when the blood flow to your heart is limited or it's blocked due to plaques and fat that are formed. So the blood flow to the heart is limited and it's causing that angina pain. The pain is very similar to a heart attack pain. So you're getting that chest pain. Sometimes you get breathlessness, sometimes you get nausea. Most patients who have angina know the feeling of it, and they have medication that they take that quickly takes the chest pain away. It dilates the blood vessels and helps more blood reach there and the pain goes away. Now, if you're someone who hasn't been diagnosed with angina, and if you have any of the symptoms of the heart attack, the box is going to appear here again. You need to ring 999 immediately for urgent medical advice. So give this a read. If you're not someone who suffers with angina, we're going to treat it like a heart attack. But if you are someone who suffers with angina, your doctor or your healthcare professional is most likely giving you a glycerol trinitrate spray, which is the medication that angina patients use to open up those blood vessels to get more blood there. Now, for angina patients, for normal angina, after using the first dose of your GTN, your glycerol trinitrate spray, the pain should go within 5 minutes. But if it doesn't, you can use a second dose. And again, if it doesn't go after 5 minutes, then you need to ring 999 immediately, because it might not be a normal bout of angina. It could be a heart attack. So this is why you need to ring 999 for urgent medical attention or to discuss with them, and they can then advise you what to do. Now let's move on to how do we prevent a heart attack. Look, hopefully you never have a heart attack or a cardiac arrest, and you're going to do things that are going to prevent you from, you know, having a risk of having a heart attack. So there's loads of things that we can do, such as if you smoke, you need to quit smoking. If you drink a lot of alcohol, if you're drinking more than 14 units of alcohol per week, again, you need to reduce your alcohol intake. If you're not exercising, you need to start exercising. You need to slowly start building up your exercise and doing more exercise to make you more fit and more healthy and make your heart more healthy. Your diet, if you're having processed foods, salty foods, ready meals, all these sort of things which are notoriously bad for you, again, they're just going to increase your risk of potentially having a heart attack. So we need to have a healthy, balanced diet. Now, I know this is all quite a lot of information I'm giving in a very short period right now, but I do have videos on all these things that I've spoke about on how to have a healthy, balanced diet, how to increase your exercise, how to reduce your, you know, your alcohol intake, how to quit smoking. I have videos on all these topics. So if any of them apply to you, please feel free to click on the description below and click on the video links that I'm going to leave down there. Another thing that you can look at calculating as well is something called your Q risk. This is how likely you are to have a cardiovascular event in the future. Your healthcare professional, your doctor's surgery, we use them all the time with patients, calculating their Q risk. It takes in many different variables and gives you a percentage risk of how likely you are to have a cardiovascular event, such as a heart attack or a stroke, within the next 10 years. It can be a really good indicator that you're doing well or you're doing really badly and you need to start making some changes. So if you are interested in knowing about your Q risk, feel free to speak about it with your healthcare professional next time you're in with them. So I really hope that you found this information helpful. You now know all about the symptoms of a heart attack. You now know all about cardiac arrest, all about angina. You now know what to do during a heart attack and what to do during cardiac arrest, and as well as what to do during stable angina when you've got angina. So you've become a bit of a pro at it, but please remember, it's always important to refresh your knowledge on these kinds of things, because you never know when you need to use this information. So make sure you refresh your knowledge on the symptoms, make sure you refresh your knowledge on what to do, and make sure you refresh your knowledge on chest compressions and using a defibrillator. Watch those videos and learn how to do it, remember how to do it, and keep on refreshing yourself, because it's very easy for you to forget them. I really hope you find this information helpful, and as I always say, I'll see you next week, sending you awesome vibes. Hey guys, thanks for watching this week's video. Make sure to click that like, follow, or subscribe button now to stay up to date with new weekly videos.